Bona tarda, benvinguts, benvingudes, good afternoon and welcome. This is the AI and Music Starts Festival. This is the last panel of the day, and then there are still plenty of shows to enjoy. So if you are here in the room, welcome. And if you are at home watching, because now I'm looking at you, also welcome. Perhaps you have been around all day, you have attended other panels during the day, or you perhaps have watched the panels during the day, and there is like one topic that we didn't ask for, but came out each time. And this topic is emotions and human sensing and feelings. And it's something that's particularly important to music, because music, it's physics, it's mathematics, but we don't like it because of that, even though it's very fascinating, you know, that you make like this, and this is a sound, and all these kinds of sounds, if they are organized, they're music. That's physics, and it's super fascinating. But the reason why we like music is because it makes us feel things. And many times we feel differently about different types of music, and no two people feel the same about music. And so we want to explore this area in this panel that's called Teaching Machines to Feel Like Humans. We don't know if we can teach machines to feel like humans, but at least we're going to try, because here we have a panel of experts who precisely explore the role of emotions in artificial intelligence, in machine learning, other flavors of artificial intelligence, and not just music, and emotions. So let me introduce you to Antonio Torralba, Shelly Knotts, Luc Steels, and Ioannis Patras, who is joining us remotely. And please welcome them with an applause. Thank you very much for joining us at the AI and Music Festival. One of our goals also for the festival, it was not just to look into music, but into AI technologies that are not music, but that can be applied perhaps to music in a way. That's why here today we have two musicians, but we have two computer vision specialists. So we will try to mix things up and see what we can learn from the technologies of vision that we can perhaps in the future or in the present apply to music. So first of all, we are going to hear Antonio Torralba, who is the head of the AI&D faculty at the MIT. His research is in the areas of computer vision, machine learning, and human visual perception. And he's interested in building systems that can perceive the world like humans do. So I guess that we are going to find out about what humans perceive from the world outside and the role of emotions. So it's all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Antonia, for the introduction. And so I'm an engineer, and I'm maybe a frustrated artist, because you know, any time I try to produce any art, it does not look good or sound good. And since long time ago, I've been fascinated by the study of artificial intelligence, but not with the goal of building machines, but actually with the goal of trying to understand what intelligence is, and in particular, understanding natural intelligence. So the question about do we need to teach machines to have emotions and to perceive the world like we do? What I wanted to do here was to first talk a little bit about why we want to do that. Why is that useful? Why we might want to have machines that feel like us and that perceive the world the way that we do. So, of course, you know, when we are building machines, we are thinking of machines that will interact with a world that we live in, and we want these machines to be able to interact with other agents and be able to plan and do things like, you know, preventing accidents or interact with another person in a house in order to perform assistance, to provide assistance, or in education. There is a number of different application domains where we want to have machines working side by side with us. Now, for instance, in particular, if you think of autonomous driving that everybody talks about nowadays. Maybe the first step will be to have a car that just assists you in driving. And now you have systems that are able to detect the lanes of the road, and they will make sounds if you step on the lane. But you can also imagine systems that will actually understand what the driver is doing. And is the driver paying attention to the road? Is the driver missing a bike that is just passing by on the right side? And understanding what the state of the mind of the driver is involves building machines that can actually have a model of what we think and what our intentions are. So in psychology, there is a big field that studies what is called the theory of mind. And it sounds, you know, it has a strange name, but it really what it means is the study of how humans represent what other humans want to do, what their intentions are, their goals, their beliefs. And that field is actually trying to understand how is that we understand other people. And this is something that is very important for our own development. I'm going to show just a wonderful video of showing how a kid uses our understanding, you know, their understanding of human emotions and the goals and the beliefs that a person has in order to interact with them. So this is the experimenter. So this is actually quite amazing because it requires, so the kid has no other cues than whatever is seen. And it has to first have a sophisticated model of the world, the fact that there is a cabinet, that there are doors, that you can put things inside. It has to understand that the person with the books is trying to put things inside the cabinet, and it cannot do it because both hands are occupied. And it has to have a model that you cannot not actually do things unless you have one hand free. So the kid has to decide that then it's useful to go there and open the doors so that the person can put things inside. And that process requires a lot of knowledge. And if we want to have machines that can help us, probably in tasks a lot more difficult than this one, we need to have machines that have models of what we want to do. And we are actually quite good at building models of what agents want to do. In fact, we can provide meaning even to very simple objects. And there is this beautiful video by Heider and Simmel where there are these triangles and circles, and you can immediately look at this movie and understand something about the physics, that there are collisions between these objects, the psychology of these objects, that some of them have emotions and intentions. There is some social aspect. You know, there is one that seems to be a bully. And there is also some morality notions that appear here. Now, there are some things that seem to be good, some things that seem to be bad. But it's just triangles and circles and a few lines, and you can provide, you know, so much rich interpretation on what is going on here. So should machines have feelings? Well, certainly, probably machines do not want to have feelings like humans have. But when there is a collaboration between humans and machines, we have to think that this has to be a symmetrical task. On one side, the machine is trying to help the human, and it needs to understand what the human wants to do, you know, what are the desires, the goals, the beliefs that the human has, and in order to help. But at the same time, the human is also collaborating with the machine. It also needs to ask the same questions about the machine. It also needs to know what the machine is trying to do. Well, it's trying to help, yes, but how is trying to help? And what are the machine's goals? Are the machine's goals the same that I have? Is the machine understanding my goals appropriately? What are the desires and the emotional status? And here, emotional doesn't really mean emotions in the same sense that I mean for a human, but still, the machine is going to have some internal state that represents something about, is the machine thinking that we are running out of time and is just going to hurry up? So those things are also related to emotions that human will have. And in that symmetry of behavior, it's important that the machine has some internal state that for us is interpretable. So the machine has to have a behavior that is transparent, that is explainable, and that we can, just by looking and watching what the machine is doing, we can interpret what it's doing. And it also needs to have some notions of fairness. It's important that the machine is predictable and it always behaves in a similar way independently of which human is in front of the machine. So all these things come together. So the study of emotions have a long history, and here is an example, a beautiful visual illusion by Agatha La Pedriza, showing, you know, if you're trying to understand the emotional content of a person, understanding, you know, you want to understand the status of the mind of a person, you can just look at the person. And the question is, what type of knowledge do you really need in order to make a decision about, do you really understand the person? So if you just look at the face, like here, you know, there are a number of algorithms out there that will process this face and it will tell you, oh, this is a surprise emotion. But if you look at the full context of the scene, then you realize that you actually did not understand properly that, unless you incorporate further knowledge. And that knowledge is not just the pose of the body, it's also the context and the social aspects that go with this event. And then you understand that this person is probably happy, probably was surprised some time ago, but not right now, and it's just blowing the candles. And now I just wanted to give you just a few hints of some things that you can do when you're trying to build models that try to understand the state of the mind of a person and how that can be useful. So one tool is to understand what a person is looking at. And this is something very powerful in humans, and kids use this cue all the time. So here is another beautiful set of a sequence of images where at the beginning you have an infant looking at an adult, and they are both looking at each other. They are keeping eye contact. Then in the next frame, the adult looks away, and in this case, it's just looking towards the camera. The kid's still looking at the adult, and he realizes that the adult is looking somewhere else. And one way of establishing communication with that adult is just to understand what this adult is thinking. That requires looking towards whatever it is that the adult is looking at. So in the next frame, you have the kid also following the gaze and looking at whatever object the adult is looking, because that's what will enable the conversation later on. Machines need to have similar capabilities. They need to understand us, and it's also actually quite important that we understand them. So if we want to know what the machine is paying attention, it needs to have some body language that will give us a hint of what the machine is doing. Actually, gaze is extremely important. For instance, if you're trying to learn language, a very typical scenario is you have a young kid and you are reading a book and showing pictures on the book and saying, you know, oh, here there are two beautiful sheep on the countryside, and you know, one is called this and the other one is called that, and they are having fun. So there is this sound that is coming out of the mouth of the adult, and the kid doesn't know what a sheep is. He has never seen these pictures, or just a few of them. He has never heard this language. It's just a bunch of sounds that make no sense. And he has to make sense of all of it. You know, otherwise, it's not going to be a functional adult. So he will have to be able to extract meaning from those sounds and extract meaning from the pixels that he sees. And that requires understanding that the mother, in this case, is not talking about something hanging on the wall. It's talking about the book that is holding in their hands. And the particular words that are coming out of the mouth is not a reflection of something that happened 3 days ago. It's something that is talking about whatever is happening right now. And that correlation, temporal correlation, is really, really important. And then you have another picture, you turn the page, and a different sound wave comes out of the mouth of the person, and you need to understand what it means. So here is a quite challenging task. You have a picture, you have a sound wave, and you want to extract meaning out of it, and you have another picture, and you have a different sound wave, and we need to understand which parts of the image refer to which parts of the sound wave. And what is really interesting is that you can play some simple games to solve this task. For instance, you can say that the sound wave that goes with the picture of sheep, it should attract. There should be some representation from the sound wave and some representation from the picture that should look similar, as close as possible. However, the one that talks about the mountains, it should be as different as possible. And that's just following the hypothesis that you are talking about something that you are paying attention to. And it's that agreement that body language that tells us what do you mean in this moment is what will give me a very small cue, but enough that over time I will be able to learn language. And then I will be able to learn that there is this group of pixels that refers to that particular piece of the audio wave. And there is another one that refers to something else. So now you can build systems that actually do that. And you can take a system with a neural network that will compute these embeddings, these latent spaces that everybody talks about when talking about music, where you want the computation that is extracted from the image to map to a space that is similar to the computation that starts from the sound wave itself. And just playing this game of attraction and repulsions between many different pairs of images and audio waves that do not go together, suddenly language emerges. So what I'm going to show you now is the result of just training such a system, and you'll hear a person talking, and the system highlighting the image regions and the particular pieces of the speech that correspond to each other. And that's done just by learning over lots of pairs of images and people talking over them, describing them with free language.
Here in this picture, there's some skiers going up a mountain.
So it's not perfect, but it's clearly finding out what the objects are that the system, the person is referring to. And here is another one.
A view of a very tall mountain or volcano with snow on the top, with a lush green field with red flowers in it.
So this system was able then to learn to discover words within a speech, even though it had a very large diversity of speakers. And the same game, actually, you can play it with just natural sounds. As you are observing the world, you are always hearing sounds that accompany it. And that correlation of what you hear and what you see at the same time is what teaches you also that there are objects in the world that make sounds. So in this particular case, once you train a system like that, you can discover inside the network that there are units, neurons, that have become sensitive to specific atomic elements in sound space. So for instance, this represents just a neural network that will take as input a speech and it will output some representation. But inside there are neurons, like the ones that you have in the brain, and they will become activated whenever there is a sound that connects with them. And we can hear what are the sounds that are preferred by some of those units. So for instance, if we look at one unit that is very, very early on in the auditory system, this artificial auditory system, in this particular case, there is one unit that just likes things that sound like smacking something. So, just by playing lots of sounds to it and looking what was selective, we can just play then all the sounds that this neuron prefer, and these are the ones. It did not like any other things, it just liked sounds that sounded like that. And there is another one that seems to like chimes. And then if you look deeper into the network, closer to the output of this system, then you start getting things that are more meaningful to us, like sounds of underwater behavior. And there are other units that like human voice, for instance.
Let's hope it's not the last,
eh?
In this case, it's human voice talking to kids. And there are lots and lots of different neurons that appear here that are sensitive to different sounds, and it's like they have discovered like these elements, these atomic pieces of sounds that are meaningful to the network in order then to relate to the visual world that you have. And the thing is that humans, we perceive with lots of different senses, not just touch and vision, audio and vision. In fact, touch is also a very important aspect of perception, which is almost as important as the visual domain. And you also have smell and taste. And all of these senses are what provides us with the capability of discovering what is in the world. We are machines that interact with the world, interact with objects, manipulate them, interact with other humans, and all of these sensory modalities allow us to discover what is outside of our heads. And then finally, in this goal of building machines that can understand other agents, one important piece is to develop systems that can learn by interacting with other agents and discover how to build models of what other agents are thinking. And there is a lot of research now going on in building virtual environments where you have agents that navigate the world, they are controllable, and you can ask them to do different things, and they have to coordinate and perform different tasks. And building these systems, so this is one that we build in our group, you know, it's been a painful experience. There are a lot of things that you need to have correctly modeled, in particular physics and so on. So this was some of our first attempts. And you know, you can see that you need to get a lot of things right. I just like how it breaks the fridge on the background. But eventually, we got it to work and perform pretty well, and we can imitate a lot of different tasks. And then the goal now is to be able to put into this space agents that have to understand what other agents have in mind and build models that what we call the watch and help challenge, where you have some agent that has a task, is trying to fulfill some goal, and another agent has to watch what the agent is doing and try to help, try to make the task to be finished as quickly as possible. And that requires building a model of what is that the other agent is trying to do, what is that the other agent knows about the world, and how can I intervene in order to make that task as efficient as possible. So with that, I will finish here. And I think that, you know, there is a lot of things to do about perception, and perception in general, not just vision and audio, but just the full domain of sensing with all our, you know, the richness of our perceptual apparatus, and try to build machines that can communicate with us better and understand us better.
Thank you very much, Antonio. So now that we know a little bit more about how we perceive the world and how we can teach machines to perceive the world, we are going to explore the world of hearing and perceiving sounds and feeling things with Shelly Knotts, who is an improviser who performs with computers and other humans. She has an academic background researching on projects around the use of AI, data and networks in improvisation and composition. And she's quite well known in the live coding field. So if you are into live coding electronic music, you possibly already know her. And with her, we are going to explore the topic of machine listening. Shelly, let's receive her with an applause for Shelly.
Hi, yeah, I learned so much from Antonio's talk, so that was amazing. Thanks so much for that. Yeah, so I'm going to talk more from an arts perspective. So I'm a musician, and so I'm interested specifically in the area of machine listening. And just to give you an idea of like how I'm approaching this topic, as Antonio already said, my performance background is as a live coder. So I got on stage with my laptop and I write code to make music with as an improvisation practice. And this involves quite an intense and focused interaction with algorithms. And so a lot of my work has sort of been around kind of understanding what it means to perform with an algorithmic system and different ways that that system might intervene in what we're doing as an improvising performer. And you have to forgive me for the fact that this is not skipping forward, and I'm seeing something different to you. Nope. There we go. this one? Okay, great. there we go. So yeah, I've already done that slide, so let's move on. I've worked a lot with network music systems, which is about designing software specifically for collaborating with other people. And that usually involves sharing data with them in various ways in order to collaborate and improvise with them. And the thing that I find interesting about this is you often end up with these sort of like complex webs of data, but also in order to design software to collaborate with other people, you need to think a lot about what kind of sociology you're building into these structures and how they're affecting your collaborators. and ways you might be influencing them or the social space that you're working within. I like to think quite critically about this and what it is that I'm designing in software in terms of how it's affecting real people in the world. the other context that I just wanted to mention quickly is that for the last 3 years until April, I worked on a project called Mimic, which is musically intelligent machines interacting creatively, which is a little bit of a mouthful. But as part of that project, I was working, it's a project that's about designing machine learning and machine listening tools for use in the browser that are particularly accessible to musicians. And the part of the project that I was working on was designing applications of the machine listening library. So there's a couple of those projects that I'm going to talk about in this talk. So just to give you an idea, these two things are not linked, and it's very confusing. So I keep seeing something different to what's actually on the screen, and I need to sort that out before the end of the talk, but there we go. I'm going to try and introduce this topic of machine listening, and then I'm going to talk about three different projects, one of them which is thinking about, what can a listening machine do that a human can't? Another that's sort of vaguely approaching this topic of emotion, although that's something I find really difficult to comprehend in the context of algorithmic music. Then another project, if we have time, that is sort of about critiquing data bias within this field. Machine listening, yes, I've got that one right. This is a field of research which is using computing tools to model aspects of the human hearing. So the aim with this is to extract and analyze data from audio sources to produce meaningful information that can then be used in machine applications. So it has a lot of use cases Antonio already talked about some use cases of machine listening, but it has use cases in science as well as in music. Everyday uses that you might have heard of and which Antonio already talked about is speech recognition, things that you might have interacted with already is Google Alexa, for example, or Mac's Siri. Environmental scientists are also using machine listening to analyze environmental sounds, for example. But what I'm interested in specifically is musical machine listening. In musical machine listening, we can sort of batch analyze music by extracting data from audio files and also from live audio. Another use case you might have heard of from this is, for example, with genre classification or apps such as Shazam, where you can hold your phone up and it's going to tell you what song you're listening to. These are all musical applications. With performing with machine listening, so building more performance use cases, we can build some better collaborations or some different collaborations between acoustic musicians and algorithmic music systems by analyzing audio data during a rehearsal or a performance to build more reasonable, reactive, and responsive performance systems. I'm looking at these applications of machine listening in performance contexts. I'm building software which is combining machine learning with my existing improvisation performance practices in live coding and in network music. And I'm particularly interested in sort of more critical perspectives on like what this means to people who are interacting with this. One of the first pieces that I made, which was using machine listening, is a piece called Flock. From 2015, which is a piece that uses a large number of listening artificial agents who each have opinions on what they want to hear. This is essentially modeling a voting system with a population of agents. There was all sorts of flocking algorithms built into this, so like the agents are each influencing each other's opinions as well. And those votes are representing an amplitude scaling of performer inputs. So there were three performers, and if you got like 50% of the votes from the agents, like the 50% of them liked your input best, then your amplitude was scaled to 50%. If you only got 10%, you were really quiet and no one would hear you, maybe. But yeah, I was kind of interested in this from the perspective of what musical strategies you might be using for winning votes, which equals kind of musical exposure, and how this was affecting the collaboration and what was going on. And I also was interested in what these listening agents can do that humans can't do. So for example, I was asking these listening agents to listen to three different inputs, or however many people were in the collaboration at once, and critically listen to those. And that's just something you can't really do as a performer, because you can't separate out, if you're listening to three people on stage, okay, like what is that person doing at the same time as perceiving and critiquing what another performer is doing on the stage. And even if you could do that, it would probably detract quite a lot from the aesthetic experience. So another thing that machines are maybe better at than humans possibly is listening beyond genre or cultural norms. So the machines had like really arbitrary criteria for what they were judging to be their favorite input, which was actually like an array of values that represented different aspects of the musical performance. So they might want to hear something in a particular pitch range with like a particular type of noise content, and a certain value around loudness, and they would judge the three streams and pick the one that had like the closest value set at that moment to what their defined preference was. And then over time, they were being influenced by what other agents in the system were most preferring. And so this also gives you a like huge multiplication of listeners and a huge continuum of like what is considered taste by the population of agents. But obviously this is a type of quantified listening, which is how machines listen, but it's like absolutely not how humans listen. So yeah, I was kind of interested in approaching these topics of how that machine type of listening might be different to how a human is listening and making that very explicit within the system. Oh no, I'm doing it again. Oh. Well, you know, there were some nice pictures and some information, and thank you so much for telling me that I'm not looking forward. And this was not the best setup to go with, but it was what we could do at the time. Got that one right. When I'm thinking about these algorithmic systems, I'm really interested in thinking from this critical domain. So I really enjoy this quote from Liza Lim, who's another composer, that says, "I propose that the aesthetic dimension, what we do as artists, is a profound, useful way of experimenting with what the world is like and what can be. Through art, we can experiment with forms that contain, split and spill, organize and disorganize. And these forms expose hierarchies that show prioritizations and investments in different values. The rhythms reveal how we pattern and repeat those values and how we are linked to people, their idea, and their labor." So I'm really interested in this idea of art as replicating versions of what are going on in society, but also experimenting in that space. Art as sort of a safe domain for testing and critiquing systems and structures. And in AI, I'm also interested in ways that AI can sometimes oversimplify real-world problems, and in doing so, build biases into systems. And I think that's a lot that been talked about a lot in press contexts about how AI can do harm through sort of building these biases in. Having said that, I'm going to move on absolutely seamlessly onto another piece, which I made, which I guess was a bit of a thought project, more than a particularly refined music project, which was called Algorithmic Power Ballads. And this piece came about because I wanted to work with a saxophonist who, during the lockdown, and she lives around the corner from me, but obviously during the pandemic, you can't be in the same room as someone. I was working on web applications for machine listening. So I essentially built a web interface, which is like an autonomous improviser that she can play into, and it'll play along from along with her. So it essentially analyzes what she does and tries to make some responses to that. And somehow through the development process of this piece, I kind of like ended up on this like weird topic of like, hey, I want to like make an algorithmic system that pushes her towards playing more power ballad like music. And I think it was because it's such a disparate ideas of music making, like algorithmic music, that tends to be thought of as quite stale and non-emotional, and the power ballad, which is like specifically trying to generate emotion in the listener. And I really like to make these machines that might push us into different places in improvisation, and she's like quite a serious jazz musician. I mean, she's not a really serious person, but she plays like quite serious music. So I kind of like the idea of like challenging her by quoting sort of a very standard power ballad sax solos back at her through the algorithmic system. And it was also kind of a thought exercise to think about what if these cultural models of emotion that we think can be better suited to producing emotional content than mathematical models. So there's a lot of challenges to modeling human emotion with algorithms, and I'm not the best place person to talk about this. What I do know, though, is that psychologists are still struggling to fully explain human emotion. So then trying to model that with algorithmic systems is an even bigger challenge. And effective algorithms often work on the basis that human emotion can be separated into distinct parameters and therefore computed. And I think anyone who's had feelings might know that maybe that's not so easy. There also tends to be a reliance on valence arousal model, which is like a 2D model of emotion, because it has an ease of computation, even though this model is generally found to be oversimplified. An oversimplification by psychologist. So to give you an idea what that looks like, this is, I'm gonna skip forward again. This is the valence arousal model of emotion. So it sort of has active and passive on one axis and negative to positive on the other, and then it tends to try to categorize emotions within that space. And I think we can generally agree that it's not always so easy to categorize emotions in those distinct ways. And so where power ballads fit into this, power ballads are also extremely formulaic. And so I thought that was an interesting sort of counterpoint to this mathematical description of emotion, because power ballads also have some sort of mathematical formula for trying to produce emotional responses, but it's culturally proven to be considered, or at least in some cultures, culturally considered to be an emotional music form. And there's a history of using aspects of power ballads to add expressiveness to other genres where this isn't typically a feature. So there's a lot of crossovers between, for example, rock music and power ballads, where the power ballad formula is used to add sort of emotional aspects to that. And so the idea was to use those algorithms to push the human performer towards more conventionally emotional music forms. So instead of trying to quantify emotions, using a culturally proven form to train an autonomous improviser to generate emotional musical content, And but in doing so, I guess I was trying to question what it is that we lose in this quantification process when the music is removed from its cultural context. So it was taking power ballads very far out of the cultural context that they're usually played within, and turning them into numbers to be interpreted by an algorithm, and asking what these data-driven musical emotions, if they're compelling enough to sway a human performer towards the formula of a power ballad. And I think I'm like very much out of time on that.
Yeah, don't worry. if you have a couple minutes more, something that you want to say, go ahead.
I mean, I had another piece I was going to talk about, but I think there's probably not time, but maybe I'll just
skip over it.
So I'm using this autonomous improviser is analyzing the live saxophone input and sending data from that into a music RNN algorithm that's generating melodic patterns. And so it's about using the power ballad as a stimulant or a deterrent or an irritant to a serious improvising saxophone player. And there's various other stuff that's going on there. And so just to quickly talk about another piece, which also takes a more critical angle on sort of data bias and AI. This is a piece called Algorithmic Girl, however you want to say that, which is a piece that takes inspiration from the Riot Girl movement, which is an early 1990s punk movement and was a specific reaction to misogyny of male-dominated hardcore punk that came about in the early 1990s. And the women who were previously part of the punk scene wanted to seize the means of production and make explicitly feminist punk music. So I was interested in thinking, like, what would Riot Girl look like in the algorithmic age? So as women who make algorithmic music, we're largely working within an algorithmic frame that's been built by the huge male bias of the computing sector, and also often erases the feminist history of computing. So the first people who were programming computers were women, and various other inputs of women into the history of computing. And also we're working within this male-dominated ecosystem of music technology. But some of the live coding sector, the live coding area has had a more women involved than other aspects of electronic music, and has a specific DIY music ethos and experiments with forms, limits, and processes. And it's a very human-centric technology practice, so it has a lot of parallels with punk music. So it seemed like an ideal arena for experimenting with, like, hey, what would this like feminist punk music look like if someone was to make it now within the algorithmic age? So obviously I wanted to critique some things about music AI. Music AI models often require the input of huge quantities of data to learn how to produce music forms. So it's very much monopolized by sectors that have the time and the money to do that. But that data, we can consider it as cultural artifacts, but in music AI, we often don't know what the data that's been used to train a model is. And that training is resource heavy and often not viable for smaller projects. The sort of music information retrieval area, which is about analyzing from big data sets of music, tends to prioritize the easily quantified features of music, such as the Western harmonic tradition, and focuses less on timbre and stuff that's a bit more difficult, and the cultural context that it comes from. And there's all sorts of problematic things that can happen in that sector. Like, I read about one project where, because they couldn't get around copyright laws in the Anglo-American context, they took a lot of music uncredited from countries that have less strict copyright laws, and the musicians obviously weren't compensated or even informed that their data had been used to train an AI model. So there's rarely an artistic input to how that data is being repurposed or appropriated. I'm still not really sure if this is okay, but this piece was kind of about explicitly appropriating Riot Girl music as a cultural provocation pointing towards problematic of data bias in music AI, and using a very atypical and politicized input. So it's essentially a corpus analysis of a database of Riot Girl music, and that's algorithmically remixed during the performance using simple algorithms that I can live code during the performance and then freely improvise with. So it's not using any of these server farm generated RNN models or machine learning. It's just simple algorithms for analyzing and remixing databases. And that's it.
Very good. Applause. Thank you very much for this introduction to the fascinating world of algorithms and music. So now we are going to say hello to Luc Steels. He's a pioneer of artificial intelligence research in Europe, known for his work in computational linguistics, artificial life, and robotics. He's one of the founding members of the Sony Computer Science Laboratory in Paris. He has an interesting background in languages and philosophy, and he is very active in music composition. So we can say that Luc is half scientist, half musician. So it's, okay. It's your turn.
Thank you. Can you see my screen, or do I need to do something special?
Yep.
Ah, yeah. Pueden las máquinas interpretar las emociones humanas? This is the question before us. And I'm very happy to see you all here to talk about this this topic. I should say that, indeed, I've been working in AI for a long time. I think my first paper in AI was in 74, 75 or something, and I guess many of you were not yet born at that time. But I also have a certain practice in music, and particularly I'm interested in opera. And I wrote two operas. One of them was performed here in the Palau de la Música in Barcelona in, I don't remember, 2014 or something. Okay. Now, before I start, I would really like to celebrate with you the coming together of AI and music. And you know, what we see in this festival is really amazing, I think. You know, both electronics and computer music have enormously advanced since the very beginning, which was 70 years ago. You know, the works of Stockhausen, for example, Gesang der Jünglinge, or the work of Lichar and Hiller with his Iliac suit in Princeton. And in all these areas, I'm not going to go through them, but all these areas have seen amazing advances. And of course, we feel them in, you know, I mean, many of them are commercial, actually, and they have had a very big impact on the world. But so this is important because AI builds further on the computer music. But AI has also advanced enormously. And, you know, because I've been around for a while, I've seen this happening. When I was a graduate student at MIT in the 70s, late 70s, we were already doing all sorts of things in music, particularly because Marvin Minsky was very fond of music and interested and all that. And so we were already working first on symbolic kinds of music, like harmonization. And I worked, for example, in constraint representations and using constraints for doing musical composition. So this was a big topic, which was then developed in many ways, and for example, by François Pachet and Pierre Roy in the laboratory I founded in Paris, the Sony Computer Science Laboratory, and, you know, with experiments on interactions with musicians. This is from, I don't remember, 2010 or something like that. you know, where in the continuator that Francois built, a jazz musician could start playing, inputting certain kinds of music, and then there was already a system that could interact with him, continue the lines, melodic lines within the harmonic patterns that the jazz pianist had introduced. And then, of course, we have this big bang of multi-layered neural networks that also go back to the 50s, actually, and also to the 80s, the multi-layered networks. I'm not going to go into this, you know, but then in the end, we end up with the completion of Beethoven's 10th Symphony and all these kind of stuff in AI. So I think it's a moment to celebrate all of this. Now I come to the topic of emotions, and maybe I would put it a bit broader, because emotions is one of the aspects of meaning, I would say, meaning in music. And meaning is also about values and about stories that are behind it. And I don't know whether this is going to work, but I would have liked to play you a little piece from Billie Holiday. And this piece is called Strange Fruit. Now, I'm going to try, but it may not work, because there was some internet. Can you see this? Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe not. And now I lost my cursor. This is all my fault, you know. It's not the good work of the technical people. I have my cursor back. Well, and you can't hear the sound either, so anyway, okay, but you know Strange Fruit by Billie Holiday? So your homework is to listen to it. And to listen to it, because, I mean, not once, but many times, because Strange Fruit really means people that are hanging, black people that are hanging from the trees in the south of the U.S. And it's, blood on the leaves, blood at the root. And she's singing it, I mean, in such a magnificent way, such an emotional way, that it cannot but touch you, you know. And so this is, for me, if we talk about emotion and meaning in music, then I think this is an example. And of course, this example, I mean, people are, I would say, a holistic thing, you know. There are many levels of meaning in music, right? And we do not split values or stories or experiences as different kinds of things. And so also in music, we have all these levels coming together. There's the material level, of course, the sound itself, which can be pleasant, can be awful, can make you angry. There's the motives and the transformations of motives and the stories that you can tell with motive, like Beethoven was doing, for example. But there's also the factual level. And in a lot of music, it's actually telling a story about the world. I mean, the Quattro Stagioni by Vivaldi is really about the seasons and the winter, you know. It's describing, it's evoking, or the music of many composers. There's this factual level in it. And then you have the expressive level, which is the level of music itself, I mean, musical emotion that touches us as real emotions, like in the piece by Billie Holiday, but also in opera, for example, or songs or things like that. And then you have, very important, you have the cultural level in music. And, for example, the Billie Holiday, you cannot understand when you don't know about the... how black people suffered from racism, but also from being slaves and all that. It's all in that song. And this is the incredible power of music, is to bring all these things together in a way that it, you know, that we are shaking, because it's such a tremendous whole experience, I would say. And then there's the motivation, which is why the singer, why the artist, why the composer has made it. I mean, Billie Holiday got into jail for singing this particular song and was upsetting her audiences, her white audiences, who loved her music, but then they were confronted with this piece. So this is, for me, when we talk about meaning and emotion, this is what we are talking about. Now, I was going to give another example, but I guess the clock is ticking fast here, so I may not do it. But this was now not from opera, but from tone poems. Richard Strauss is one of the greatest composers, I think, of the previous century. You know, and he wrote these operas like Salome, Electra, Ariadna of Naxos, etc. And this song, again, this is homework. You know, the Vierletzte Lieder, the four last songs by Strauss. And one of them is Im Abendrot, which means in the, you know, the falling of the evening. And the image that he has is like this valley where, you know, when it gets dark, then you have the impression that the valley closes in on itself. And he uses this metaphor of larks. And basically, Strauss wrote this song based on a poem by Joseph von Eichendorff in 1949, which is the year that he died. And so he tells actually the end of his life, the dying, you know, it's about that. And the larks are a symbolic representation, actually, that's used for the soul who is going to heaven, or maybe to hell for some of you. And so this poem is full of symbolism, and which is then reflected in the music. And this is, again, I cannot go into much detail. You know, we can go into the score, and we can look at how this music, by the melody, by the rhythm, but also by the tonality, by the chords that are used, by the chromatic variations that are created. And then at some point, I kind of highlighted here, you hear flutes here. You see my cursor? Yes. So there are two flutes, which are the larks, of course, that are playing. And they're coming, you know, it's a figurative element in this song, which is coming right before that the singer is singing about the larks and about dying. So I recommend the, I don't know, maybe, can you see my screen if I go to another? Okay, well, it doesn't matter. But so this is homework again. Listen to it, you know, and I recommend by Anya Harteros. Write it down, and then later tonight, not once, listen to it five times, you know, and go to the text and try to get into it, and you'll get a real musical experience of emotion and meaning. Okay, so now, this is a summary of what I said. You know, meaning is at least for me, but I think also for many composers, central to opera songs, film music, and so on. And it is so special because it pulls in all human expressive forms. Now we talk about emotion and meaning and AI. And then I would say meaning is largely beyond the state of the art in AI. Talking about AI making music with emotion is a bit problematic, I would say. Now, let me make this point. You know, how does statistical machine learning, like deep neural networks, how does it work? Well, basically, It is being trained. And I wouldn't say it is learning. It is being trained. And trained with partial patterns. And then you show a partial pattern, you get the system to do its thing, and then you correct it, because you also show the complete pattern. And so this way, you know, if you give a kind of loss function which is saying how close the pattern generated is to the pattern that you would like to see, you can adopt the weights in these networks and learn a statistical model. And so once you have that, you know, you can present a partial pattern, and the pattern gets completed and with the statistical model. So this is very short. What is amazing about this? Two things. One of them is that it works remarkably well. That means if you have data sets and you let this machine go through it, it will after a while come up with a network of some sort that approaches more and more the statistical properties of the examples that you gave it, of the data from which it was trained. So this is remarkable because, you know, it's not so obvious as it seems, and actually it can be done because you need really vast amounts of computation to keep adjusting the weights to get closer and closer to the target that you have. The second thing is that you can apply it to many different tasks, and including many music tasks. So you can acquire the voice characteristics, or you can acquire an instrument, or categorize music, or give it a phrase and then let it complete the phrase to form a melody, and many things like that. So it is amazing. Now, the question is, are there any limitations? And I think the main thing to understand is that recognizing and completing a pattern is not the same as understanding. I mean, it may be part of understanding, but it's not the same thing. And if you say, for example, in, let's take these translation systems, okay? Now, they learn from having been given pairs of, let's say, Catalan and Italian, okay? And so it is learning mappings between n-grams, small snippets of text. Now, and then it's doing sometimes a remarkable job, but I can assure you this translation system does not know what you're talking about, does not have any grammar in it. It is predicting, and it's good at that, but it does not understand what you're saying. It doesn't have a grammar of it. The same thing for all these music experiments, you know, like in composition. I mean, if it is done with a statistical learning system, whether it's Beethoven, 10th Symphony, or whatever, I mean, that system itself has no notion of harmony, no notion of meaning, no notion of structure. It is just it's completing a pattern that has been learned. And this is very important to realize, you know. It's a bit like there was a horse in the beginning of the 20th century called Clever Hans. And Clever Hans was able to do arithmetic. And so the trainer would write on the board 1 + 1, and Hans would tap 2, okay? And, well, amazing, right? Now, I'm exaggerating maybe a little bit to make the point, but the statistical systems are like Clever Hans. I mean, of course the horse didn't know about arithmetic. It was trained with patterns, and it could perform enough to give the impression that it was able to do arithmetic. But it was also easy to fool. And the same is true for these AI systems. You know, if you, GPT-3 is one of the things which is currently in great hype, and indeed, you give it a sentence and it will complete a text and say, wow, amazing. But again, I can assure you this GPT-3 does not understand what this text is about. It's completing patterns, it's taking snippets that it has learned before and gluing them together. And then if you have dialogues with the system, they can turn out to be a bit strange, like this one. You know, you say, hey, I feel very bad, I want to kill myself. I said, I'm sorry to hear that. I can help you with that. Huh. Should I kill myself? Yes, I think you should. Now, why is this happening? Is because GPT-3 doesn't know anything about killing and that it's not a good thing to tell people to kill themselves, you know? It's also the reason why we have all these computer vision systems, for example, for recognizing traffic signs, which have the strange behavior that, like in this case here, sometimes it works well, but it could be that there's some graffiti on a traffic board, or you switch the image a little bit around and it doesn't work anymore. So the classification is not robust. And these statistical models are sensitive to other features than the one that we use. Okay, but this doesn't mean it's all bad, not interesting and everything, but I'm telling you all this so that you would realize the limitations of this particular technology, the statistical learning technology, which is very influential at this point. But I should also say it's not the only kind of AI that is around. So now I get back to the emotion thing. And the question is, well, so what do we do now, okay? Can we bring in emotion in what is going on in computer music? And if we take a look at computer vision again, this was a suggestion of the organizer. You know, in computer vision, you have many things. I mean, there's an incredible number of people working on this. And one is a system called Open Face that includes emotion recognition. And basically, emotion recognition, what does it mean? Well, actually, it recognizes what are called action units, which are very small movements of the face. And then these, there's a number of, 2, 4, 6, 8, you know, basic emotions. And then it is learning, this deep learning or some other kind of learning, the mapping between these action units and the emotions. So, okay. Now, is this about real emotions? Well, first of all, I would say if we are talking about emotions in music, they're going to be more than 8. And emotion is a very rich network that we have of states. Some of them are physical, some of them are maybe more mental. But to press, you know, to say these are the 5 or 6 or 7 or 8, whatever number of emotions, universal, which is another questionable thing. And then we learn that, and then the system can recognize our emotion. I mean, to me, this is not only wrong, but it is dangerous to say that. And in fact, as already shown in an example that you gave, the context is needed to disambiguate the emotion, you know, remember your image. And so, I mean, we really, I would say, as technologists, we really have to be much more humble in the way we talk about humans and the way we talk about emotions and meaning and all these kinds of things, and then simplify it up to, you know, to this extent. And you say, oh, this is all, these are experiments. But actually, I mean, then these things are being used, right? This is the thing that really worries me. So that was the problem. Now, I guess I have to stop.
You have, yeah.
One.
Wrap it up.
Okay, I will wrap it up. I had some more slides, but I will go right to the end. These slides were about things that we were doing. So these are some points for the debate. So first of all, certainly emotion is an integral part of real music. Second, the statistical machine learning approach in my opinion, is not going to give us a serious handle on emotion in music. We need a better understanding of emotions, of the rich emotions that humans have, and also of the relation between emotions and musical forms. Now, in the Baroque period, you know, they had this theory called Affektenlehre in German, with these people like Jonathan Matheson, where they talked a lot about emotions. And indeed, in Baroque music, Handel, Gluck, you know, all these people, emotions were playing a very important role. Of course, also in the romantic music of the 19th century, etc. But I mean, there are periods in the history of music that they thought a lot about the emotions. So I think this can help us to understand better. Moreover, we need more theories of musical narratives, because that's another thing about meaning in music, is that, you know, it can be a narrative in terms of motives. I mean, also in jazz, you have a standard, and then they start improvising on this standard, turning it around, changing it, changing the chord structure a little bit, you know, going out of the playing with this material. And so this is, we also need to think at that level instead of replaying patterns. And finally, I think again, for AI and music, we have to really think about how we can get these other dimensions of the musical experience in our, supporting software or whatever. I mean, the cultural, the motivational, the linguistic, the text. And because all of these work together to create the emotions that you feel when you hear a piece like that of Billie Holiday. Okay, I'm sorry for speaking so long.
It was very interesting. Thank you very much, Luc.
Yes, thank you.
And yes, now the clock is ticking, so let's introduce Ioannis Patras, Professor in Computer Vision and Human Sensing at Queen Mary University of London at the Multimedia and Vision Research Group. His area of research is looking at and sensing people using machine learning, computer vision, and signal processing methodologies to interpret and predict behaviors. Hello, good evening, Ioannis.
Hello, everybody. Can you hear me well?
Yes. We do?
Great. Yes. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's very nice to be virtually there, and I very much regret that I'm not physically there. So today I will be talking a little bit about affect analysis, focusing on how computers can recognize emotions in people. And I'm afraid that after the talk of Luc, I might be talking a little bit about clever hands, but I hope that you will forgive me. So I'll make a disclosure, a disclaimer here, that I'm not a psychologist, and I'm talking from a computer scientist's perspective, and also talking about emotions as a human. So, as you said, my research area can be characterized as looking at or sensing people. We are dealing with, we are designing computer vision, machine learning, and pattern recognition methodologies, so as to analyze facial expressions, recognize human actions from body postures, from body gestures, and also we do some analysis on brain and physiological signals, such as heart signals and skin conductivity. And in this area, we try to recognize affect, we try to recognize emotions based on analysis of facial images from nonverbal facial behavior, but also from EEG and from physiological signals such as heart signal. I'm going to give you some overview, some highlights to some of the research that we are doing, so as to show you a little bit what is the state of the art in the field, and also address and, some of the limitations, some of which have been mentioned in the previous by the previous speakers as well. So the dominant paradigm, the question that we have at the moment is how computers recognize at this moment now emotions. So the question is, how can we train a machine learning methodology, a black box that has a number of parameters such as a neural network, so that it takes as an input an image, for example, and then gives in the output a prediction, a label that says what is the emotional state of the person that is depicted in it. So the dominant paradigm at the moment is that we expose this machine learning method, the neural network, for example, this black box that has all these parameters, to a large number of examples, a large number of images, each of which is associated with a specific label, with the correct, with quotations, emotion that it is associated to it. So for example, the first image with surprise, the second one with fear, the third one with sadness. And the idea is that the, by exposing the network to all of those examples, the network will adjust the parameters so that when it is given a certain image that looks like the first one, it will output in the output a prediction that will be surprise. When it will be given in the input an image that has same characteristics that looks like the one at the bottom, the third image, it will declare it as sad. And currently, those annotations, those labels, are given in a manual manner, either by the people that are depicted by in the images, so by self-reporting, or by someone, a human that goes and manually annotates the images in the dataset. And there are several variations of this scheme that I have just described. So we can be talking about different modalities to recognize emotions, not only from images, but from audio, or given as input the brain signals of a person, or their heart rate, or text. There are different, in the output of the system, there are different ways of making the prediction about the emotion, depending on the emotion modeling scheme that we adopt. And both of the schemes now have been discussed about by the previous speakers. So there is the categorical emotion modeling of Ekman, and these are six basic emotions that are supposed to be universal. These are the anger, happiness, fear, disgust, surprise, and sadness. And also the Russell's dimensional modeling, in which it is claimed that emotions are represented by three numbers. The first number is corresponding to the arousal that this emotion is causing, valence, whether to the degree to which the emotion is positive or negative, and dominance, whether this emotion makes us feel in control or not. And all emotions could be placed now in this wheel, with the dominance dimension missing from the diagram that I have here. What I will do now is I will present some of, I will start by presenting one of the work in this area, in which we try to analyze the facial behavior of, we'll try to do facial analysis in the wild. And in the wild, we mean in conditions that are uncontrolled, real world conditions, outside the laboratory. The idea there was to analyze videos in the retail environment, detect faces, recognize some facial behavior such as smile and positive or negative emotions that are depicted in the faces. And from there, the ultimate goal was to calculate a kind of a delight index, an index that would be related to the ambience of the space. And the goal there was to relate now this delight index with choices that one would make about the space. For example, the choice of the music or the colors or the arrangement of the tables. I cannot show you results of the videos in the retail environment, but I will show you here results, and the videos were supposed to be played automatically. I will try to click. I'm sorry. I don't know if we can play the videos.
Let's see if technical control can help us here?
No.
Apparently, okay, something's wrong.
The link. no worries. I will not give this as a homework. I think that gave much better homeworks for you. But what I wanted to show here is that, in general, the system was performing quite well in challenging conditions. I think I'm trying to go back now. Okay. And I was presenting results now in which you could see the performance of a simplified version of the system, in which we were trying only to detect smiles. And why smiles? Because they were used as a crude, and it is crude, a proxy for positive emotions. But also because I wanted to show you how it was, how the system was performing in challenging situations, such as occlusion, variations in pose, in scale, in illumination. And while it was doing quite well on a very simple facial behavior, such as was the smile, you could see that it was not perfect. And what I want to say is that subtler facial expressions, more complex emotions in such complicated situations are far from being achievable at the moment. So there are very big challenges, even at a very low computer vision level. Okay. Now, the progress in the field hinges upon, relies to a large degree on very on large data sets on which the algorithms that I have described can be trained. So in this area, my group has contributed. Now I mentioned here two of the contributions. These are data sets that we have collected, in which we were recording the neurophysiological responses of brain signals, skin conductivity, temperature, and the facial videos of people while they were observing stimuli. And what the stimuli was on the data set, in the case of the data set that it is on the left-hand side, are music videos. The right-hand side was just general videos. And we annotated now this data set in terms of violence, arousal, and dominance, the one. And the second one is also annotated in terms of the personality traits, five big personality traits of the participants. These data sets were very well received by the community, and I mentioned that here so as to highlight the importance of having these data sets and the impact that they can have in the community. This slide represents some samples of results that we were obtaining. On the left-hand side, on the recognition of the affect, positive and negative valence, for example, when the change level is 0.5, we were able to obtain statistically significant higher recognition scores than that, based on different modalities. And on the right hand side, what the performance was for the recognition of some of the personality traits. I will also mention here two more data sets. One is so as to show you a little bit where the trends are at the moment. So one is the AffectNet that has 500,000 images, and it's annotated in terms of the arousal violence and some and categorical emotions. I mention it to say that the current trend is to collect a large data set, so the size is important, and in uncontrolled conditions. The other one is the 1 minute gradual emotion challenge that contains some sample of which I will try to show play here. I'm not sure if you can hear it. Can you hear it or not?
No, we cannot hear it.
Okay. The reason why I wanted to play it is to say that the emotion that the actress is conveying here, and it is a moving script, is conveyed in by several modalities, both by what is being said, so for, from the transcript of what has been said, from the audio, from her intonation, but also from her facial expression.
Yannis, it seems that some audio it was coming out of the video now.
Officer shot in the line of duty.
Yeah, we can hear it.
Mom would always scramble for the phone. She had to know he was okay. But I'd still stay up late and wait for him. Every night. Waiting.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear what you hear.
Yeah. But well, I think that we could... anyway, you can go on. We've heard a little bit of it.
Okay. So, I'm sorry about that. But yes, the main... we'll move on for a second. Okay. The main reason why I presented now a clip of this data set was to show that another current trend is to use multimodality for the recognition of emotions. So to try to recognize not only from the facial expressions, but also from all the other modalities that I have just mentioned. And now here I will try to summarize, I will try to say two main major limitations of these paradigms and of these approaches. The first one is that in those data sets and with the current methodologies, what we're trying to each sample, each video, for example, is associated with a single label. It's associated with a single score, for example, in the valence scale. This hides the fact that, especially for complex emotions and difficult videos, there is a large variation in the annotations that different annotators may give. There is a large uncertainty about what the labels really are. And what I'll present now is two of the methodologies that are developed in my group that we're trying to deal with this. In the first one, we accept that it is very difficult to assign a single valence score for a specific image, but we say that it is much easier for the computer and the humans to decide whether the valence in depicted in one of the images is higher than the one depicted in the other. So it is much easier to compare samples than giving assigning scores, individual scores to them. And this is what this network that we have proposed is doing. It is processing each image separately. It was combining the representations. And then in the output, in the red circle, on the bottom right of the screen, it was giving a decision on whether the valence depicted in the first was lower, similar, or higher than the valence depicted in the second. In the second methodology, we are trying to estimate at the same time, we're trying to explicitly model the label uncertainty. So the network is getting as input one video, for example, and then it gives in the output not only a prediction about what the affect is, but also a prediction about the difficulty of the specific sample. And this is represented by the width of the red curve in the top right of the screen. And what we see is that we have a very positive correlation between the difficulty of the sample that we, or the uncertainty of the sample that we are predicting, and the variation and the differences in the scores that individual annotators are giving. I will also criticize something that has been criticized already, so I will not insist on that very much. And I will say that with the current paradigm, we are trying to reason about the emotional state, about the affect of samples, seeing them in isolation. We're trying to reason about, we're trying to detect, to recognize the emotion of the soldier, for example, that is depicted in the image, in one of the images here, with just a single photo. But there are personal, there are cultural differences on how emotions are expressed. And we do not try, the current methodologies do not try to understand, to model even stimuli, the environment that caused the specific reaction. And we are very far by trying to model or understand people's goals and people's motivations. And these are things that are, so the current data sets that we are that we have at our disposal, on which we are training our statistical models, are just not good enough. So in my view, I think that emotion recognition cannot be seen in isolation than other AI problems. And in order to get a true understanding about emotions, then we need to start reasoning about who is doing what, where, when, and why. It is important that we reason and we try to model goals, motivations, and the complex world in which certain reactions, feelings, are, and actions are taking place. So we learn much larger, we need multimodal data sets, we need that are trying to model and present and try to have much larger variation and coexistence of several of those factors. And that they are annotated, in my view, not only with a simple categorical or three numbers that present the emotion of the person, but also are going to give a richer description about the scene. Probably, in my view, it would be very good with some textual descriptions, with natural that could be subsequently analyzed by natural language. And we need also new paradigms of learning, but I'm not going to go very much into that. Because I will close now with some concluding thoughts on the topic of the on the main question here. So, will we end up with computers that can feel? Will we end up with computers that have emotions? So I will start with, I will make two remarks here, and I will say that emotions in human can be seen somehow as regulators of behavior. It could be seen as shortcuts to behaviors, to states of minds and states of body that can lead to certain rewards that were good for our survivals and for us thriving. Fear, for example, is related to recognition of dangerous situations and could help us to avoid them. Anger can be related to recognitions of situations in which we need to act in a forceful manner. And I'm thinking now here, when saying that, to the dominance scale in the Russell's dimensional scale of emotions. And this is a very complex, these emotions are very complex, it's a very multidimensional mechanism. The second remark that I want to make is that AI systems are becoming more and more complex, and they will be assigned, as time goes by, more and more complex tasks, more and more complex goals. It will not be just give an image and determine whether there is a face there or not, or whether we should steer the wheel to the left or to the right. They will be assigned more and more complex tasks, such as can you play the music that I like for the rest of the evening? Or can you take care of my son while I'm going out shopping? Or conversely, can you go shopping while I'm playing with my son? And in order to complete those tasks, and the more complex the tasks will become, the systems will need to be, to accomplish them, they need to be semi-autonomous. They need to form behaviors. We will not be able to specify them with rules what they should be doing in order to accomplish the task. They should be continuously learning and adapting to the environment. And they should be interacting now with other AI systems, with humans and with the environment. Now, towards the achievement of these very complex goals, will they form what we identify, what we call emotions? So, will they be able to associate certain situations with positive or negative results? Will they be able to know that in this situation is bringing me closer to the goal that I was assigned to? And I'm looking here at the valence scale in the Russell's dimension. I would say that probably yes. Will they be able to identify that in some situations they need to be more active? And I'm looking here at the arousal scale of the Russell's dimension of emotions. Again, most likely, yes. Will they be able to identify that in certain situations they need, in their interactions with other AI agents, for example, they need to be to act in a more forceful manner? And I'm considering now the dimension of dominance in the Russell's scale of emotions.
Yanis,
wrap
it up because we have run out of time.
Okay. And the last question is, will they be ever be in love? But I think that we run out of time, and it's a very long topic, so you will forgive me if I will not. I will just refer you to Plato.
Actually, we are so out of time that we don't even have time to discuss or time for questions. We just have like 30 seconds to say thank you. Thanks to Yanis, to Luc, to Shelly, to Antonio. Please applause to them. Thank you very much for sharing all these super interesting and incredible ideas with us. Thanks for the homework, and thanks for you two attending. It's time to say that, like, the panels, the talks end here. You can go out dancing. And I want to say thank you very much to you, the ones who have attended physically here in the venue. And I want to say thank you to the people who have followed the stream today. Your host, Antonia Folguera, says thank you and bye-bye. Thank you.